the voice inside the Trebum's memories assured it that while the tower stood, the Trebum would be safe. The power of the Eternal Cylinder was contained for now. This relative tranquility gave the Trebum a chance to think about its family. Trebum are not meant to live alone, so where were the others? Our young friend had found an egg, a Trebum egg, with one of his siblings inside. The egg had been abandoned, but it could still be made to hatch. All that was needed was a source of heat. It was hard for the Trebom to know what to do or where to go. But the friendly voice suggested this was not the right way. To find your path, it said, you must follow the beam of light that emanates from the tip of the tower and stay away from the deep waters where the old things dwell. This door had been built for Trebom. It gave them hope that in this large and dangerous world, some places had been made for them. Somehow, this ancient statue transferred knowledge to the Tremor. It was as if a memory had been stored inside it, waiting for someone to absorb it. And as soon as this knowledge had entered their minds, the Trebum realized that there was a great library of information hidden away in the web of their memories. But why was the knowledge of a specific ingredient placed here in this Trebum made of stone? Thank you. Inside the cave, the Trebum found a living elder. It had been waiting in this chamber for a long, long time. The elder told them it was happy to see some friends before the cylinder came. It said, "You are young, so you never knew the time when our people could shapeshift at will. We, Trebum, are inheritors of a vast tree of abilities. Abilities passed on to all future Trebum. But this power is being taken away. Beware the servants of the cylinder. They will seek to hurt you at every opportunity, and they have the power to rob you of your abilities. But if you persevere, one day you will find a way to protect yourselves from their evil light. Farewell, my brave friends. I fear I am too old and tired to join you. May you find a way to prosper in this time of struggles." It was not easy to leave the cave, but the elder had urged them to go forward. Suddenly, they felt the weight of their many tasks: to find their Trebum siblings, to restore the powers their people had lost, and it all seemed a little daunting. But even when they are afraid, Trebum are stubborn. The cylinder resumed its destruction. Nothing could stop it forever. They needed to roll to safety, to find another tower to protect them quickly. The Trebum found themselves almost as lost as they had been in the beginning. But the voice and their memories comforted them. It was only natural to be confused, it said. They had been born into a strange, broken world, cut off from the history of their ancestors. Everyone was a little lost these days. What mattered was to keep going, to keep looking for answers, to keep carrying the light they held within them, the light that stopped the cylinder. In this strange, eerie temple, the Trebum felt something stir in their memories. There was a great power in this place. Something from the days when even the elders were young. Perhaps it could help them. Thank you. Of all the changes the Trebum were experiencing, growing a third eye was the strangest one yet. To make things even stranger, this eye seemed to look in two directions at once, into the world and into their memories. They could use it to find in the real world any element that was contained in the web of their memories. It was truly a remarkable mutation. The Trebum were disoriented for a moment. Something new had entered their memories and they needed to make sense of it. It seemed to be a map. And on this map, a location had been marked. If they understood correctly, there was some manner of serpent, a guardian, a greater being of some kind somehow linked to a safe haven. Could they find refuge there? Their ancestors must have created this map for a reason. What manner of strange beast lurked behind the cylinder? The Trebum were deeply unsettled by this new mystery. But though some part of them was curious, they were certain it would be best not to find out. As their fear faded, the Trebum started feeling weak and tired. With all the excitement and adventure, they'd neglected their most basic needs. The sound of an empty stomach reminded them that survival requires more than escaping from danger. You also have to eat. Luckily, one of the many gifts of the Trebum is the capacity to store food in their bodies. But they still need to digest it to gain the vital energy that gives them strength. And for such small creatures, they do require rather a lot of food. Fortunately, the savannah was rich in flora and fauna, which would satisfy their little bellies without necessarily triggering a mutation. was this strange being, half flesh, half metal? The Trebum felt an old, distant horror, as if they remembered their own destruction. Something about this creature was very, very wrong. Perhaps the creature would wake up with a loud noise. Trapped on all sides by deep pools of poisonous gas, the Trebum needed to find a way to escape this monstrosity. Perhaps there was a way to use the creature's own weight to lower the bridge? One by one, the yellow light cruelly burned away the Trebum's abilities. The Elder had warned them about the evil light of the cylinder's servants. Now they knew what kind of creature to avoid. cylinder roared with fury. The voice in their memory spoke with great urgency. The Trebom had to be very careful now. The cylinder would lash out at the lad, but it would not let them run too far. To survive, they would have to stay in the eye of the storm. As frightening and surprising as this enormous creature was, the Trebom felt a sense of relief to see it descend from the sky. This was the celestial being they'd been told to seek. Perhaps it held an answer to their troubles. As they approached the colossal creature, their optimism faded. It did not seem to like them at all. And now they realized what terrible danger they were in. If this creature guarded the way to some holy place, then that place must lie below it. And being so large, the creature most likely could not see what was in front of it or beneath it. So perhaps the size of the Trebom was an advantage after all. Perhaps they could reach the platform right under the serpent's head. As frightening and surprising as this enormous creature was, the Trebum felt a sense of relief to see it descend from the sky. This was a celestial being they'd been told to seek. Perhaps it held an answer to their troubles. As they approached the colossal creature, their optimism faded. It did not seem to like them at all. And now they realized what terrible danger they were in. If this creature guarded the way to some holy place, then that place must lie below it. And being so large, the creature most likely could not see what was in front of it or beneath it. So perhaps the size of the Trebum was an advantage after all. Perhaps they could reach the platform right under the serpent's head. arrived at having bested the Guardian, the Trebum now found themselves seeking the help they had been promised. Who would answer their questions in this place? Even with the light, the maze was difficult to traverse. Was there some clue in the structures on the walls? Was the path of sand on the ground meant to help them? Perhaps others had walked in this place long ago and tried to leave a path for those who would one day follow them.
I'm gonna go now. Aware, how to go up, 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 a
encountering another elder was a happy moment. The Trebom asked how they might survive the cylinder. And the elder replied, "I can feel your fear, little ones. Ever since this cataclysm began, we have been seeking ways to stop it. But the cylinder is relentless and indestructible. It will consume everything in its path. So, perhaps what we need to do is go behind it. I have discovered a mutation that allows us to rise into the sky. You must seek a weeping tree from which grows a special fruit that floats as it becomes ripe. It is the key to the transformation I have undergone. With it, you can use geysers to float well above the cylinder's height. My only regret is that I have grown too old and weak to help you with this task. If you find any glimmer of hope on the other side, remember me. Farewell." Sadness and fear filled the Trebom's hearts as they left the Elder's cave. Their only path to salvation was full of uncertainty, and they could not forget the thing they had seen lurking behind the cylinder, casting a dark shadow over this glimpse of light. The Trebom had never seen this mysterious tree the Elder spoke of. They would have to keep moving forward and hope it lay somewhere ahead. The cylinder would give them no other choice. They were still nowhere near the mysterious tree they were supposed to find. But the voice in their memories encouraged them. It was wise in matters of root and rock, and it could sense the soil under their feet changing. Step by step, they were getting closer. shadows had fallen and the light was lost. There was no more point in running. The cylinder would consume everything.
Thank you.
was this monstrous creature? Was this one of the cylinder servants? The ones the Elder had warned them of? Its very form terrified the Trebon. Even the voice and their memories seemed frightened of it. And then, somehow, the Trebon remembered the creature's name. It was called the Mathematician. Finally, the weeping trees that the Elder had told them to find were within the Trebon's grasp. But though the Trebon were happy, they realized that they faced a new challenge. The ripe fruit were floating out of reach, and the others were enclosed in a hard shell. They would have to find a way to crack them open. Even with the ability to float, overcoming the cylinder would have to be done very carefully. What they needed was a geyser that was well positioned close to the cylinder when it lay still, or their plan would never work. They would have to keep looking, and meanwhile, they would try not to think about what sort of monster could kill one of the flying serpents. Thank you. When the Trebham stepped on the strange device, an ancient memory came back to them. A memory of long ago, when the cities of their people still stood, and the fight against the cylinder was not yet lost. In those days, a very smart Trebham had found a way of cheating the cylinder, of stealing a little bit of its power to absorb and to reshape. In this way, the Trebham could revive their fallen friends or send others to a hidden place. And it was also by this device that a link had been forged and a path had been opened to the voice that spoke within them. In the dream inside the strange giant's mind, the voice that spoke to the Trebham seemed different. It was less like a memory, more like something alive. But there were so many other voices too, lost in this place.
I remember the mountains of my home. The vast forests, the clouds hanging low overhead, the cities in the valleys where the rivers run. I remember the faces of my children and the songs we sang when the stars rose high. But I have forgotten the names of all these things, and slowly one melts into the other. My children will become mountains, the forests will become songs, and then all will become one and be nothing.
Wanted the Trebon to find it. Each voice was a memory, a song from a forgotten time slowly fading. But some of these memories were Trebon memories, memories of things that Trebon had once been capable of. Perhaps, the voice suggested, these could be reclaimed.
I remember how our towers stretched out to the sky, yearning for the stars. They were symbols of our best and our worst. I remember our voices echoing in the canyons as we fought for change, for a world that was different. Then it came, and the towers fell, and there was no more difference. Where are our voices now? Where are our songs? I only hear one, and it is eternal.
As the memories returned to the Trebon, old abilities stolen by the cylinder were finally restored. But there was so much more. The voice had answers, but it was weakening. Frightening as it was, the Trebon would have to come back. This was a place of death and nothingness. There were no answers to be found here. The voice and their memories urged them to return to the lands of the living. A profound feeling of futility overcame the Trebbon. Despite having miraculously survived their encounter with the mathematician, they were back to where they'd started. To make matters worse, ahead of them lay the cold and snowy lands of the tundra. Not a very nice place for Trebbon, who are not meant to live in the cold. They would have to push forward against all odds and pray that they could find help. With this new pair of eyes, the Trebbon felt, well, to be perfectly honest, they felt rather silly. But despite that, the voice in their minds told them, with these eyes they could learn much about the creatures they encountered. The voice was glad about this. It was knowledgeable in the manner of animals, and now it could contribute its wisdom to their memories.
Thank you.
This time, the Trebon knew what they were feeling. Here was another servant of the cylinder. But what shape would this creature's evil take? It did not seem interested in the Trebon. The servant of the cylinder had released a swarm. Small parasites had come from within it and attached themselves to the creatures in this area. It was somehow using them to corrupt the tower, to turn its protective force into a trap. All Trebon hate parasites by nature, and they hated these even more. They would have to remove them, but how?
Mm-hmm.